First of all, I just wanted to thank the panelists and particularly the researchers for what I thought was a really fascinating set of presentations and collections of reports. I'm going to very, very selfishly just try and get the panel and everyone else in the room to solve problems for me. So I broadly agree with the broad thrust of the analysis, but a lot of the challenges are in the implementation, and I wanted to highlight three particular areas and get the panelists' reflections on how we might, either through further research or improved practice, take some of those on. So the first, which we face a lot in our work, is the balance between institutional coherence and political payoffs. So the danger with institutional coherence is that you can treat institutional coherence as an end in itself. And you can see this where public service reform becomes focused on the structures, the functional reviews of the ministries, cross-cutting, pay reform, and so on, which can be important but can also absorb a lot of energy without actually leading to results that politicians value. And so working out the bits of coherence that are actually getting the way of implementation rather than aiming for coherence per se, I think it's quite a difficult challenge to navigate. The second one is, how do you spot a window of opportunity? I think the emphasis is right, and we were talking earlier about the kind of obvious ones, like an election or a change of leadership. Maybe, I don't know what the other ones are, but I was very struck within AGI that we, like most organisations, have risk registers for our projects. And I, in a sort of fit of wonkery, thought maybe we should have opportunity registers. And so I started trying to think through how would I identify an opportunity and then the subsequent action that should follow from that. It was actually very, very difficult. And so any advice on how you might systematically look for opportunities, I think would be really, really valuable for a lot of organisations in this area. And then the third one is measurement. I think one of the implications of the kind of iterative PDIA approach is that you need a lot more what's so-called impact monitoring as opposed to post hoc evaluation, because you need to know, is this working? What changes do I need to make? And that implies much shorter feedback loops, probably being more comfortable with more uncertainty and dirtier data. So anything you can say about what the implications for measurement and evaluation are of your thinking would be really useful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I think just forward, a couple gentlemen here, if people could just say who they are when they start.
Hello, I'm Peter Owen. I'm an independent occasional consultant. Very interesting. One of the points I took from it was that donors could do this, but the question that the panel has raised is, will they? And one of the issues in here is the management intensity of this approach. Doing things like, even basic things like finding out what's going on at local level, who's doing what in the office, are there enough people, and what additional burdens will they have to take on in order to implement the program. And then there's rather more difficult things like building coalitions, where it's never in the gift of any one often to achieve a result. And there's sort of working through the order of difficulty in things that donors might want to do to implement this approach. There's trying to develop multi-stakeholder approaches, which incidentally might, some circumstances, avoid the danger of being too closely allied with a ministry if you're working with all the stakeholders that are involved in delivery of a service. And then finally, being ready to exploit windows of opportunity. If you're starting from scratch when something opens up, then you're not necessarily going to be effective because the window might have closed. All this means that you have to be there with a very good knowledge of what's happening and who the stakeholders are, where they're coming from, and how to work with them, and with some ideas of what to do to exploit windows of opportunity. So I would, given all this, I wonder how well does this approach fit with current donor ideas on, for example, doing more with less, which I think was the slogan when I left DFID 5 years ago. Are these examples outliers, or could we expect them to be close to the norm for what donors might do? Now, the second point is that there is, as I think as
you can make it brief, please.
Okay,
just
sorry. As Sue indicated, there's a political economy to donor approaches too. And I think that two things might help with that. One is answering the so what question. Okay, you tackle these donor constraints. How much better was implementation as a result? You really do need to answer that question if donors are going to be interested. And the second one is, what about Asia? A lot of donor money is spent in Asia. And an approach that research that purely looks at Africa is not going to be influential over that area of government expenditure.
Thank you very much. I've clocked three on this round, Duncan, Lenny, Marcus. If people could just sort of indicate if they like, and we'll take a second round.
Yeah. Great. Excellent paper, excellent presentations. Duncan Green from Oxfam. I wanted to just take Sue's question and pass it back to the panel. So if you did this approach and your positive deviance study was donors getting it right, what do you think, from what you've looked at, would be the factors behind donors doing the good stuff and getting these kind of things right? What have you seen so far? And don't say it needs more research. Just give us an answer, okay? And then taking Peter's point, I mean, is one option of this having too much money? This is not something I would say as Oxfam, but having too much money floating around. Can you ring fence the kind of skill, knowledge-intensive bit of work and keep people doing that and not swamp it with having to spend millions of dollars and somehow keep the capital-intensive part of the aid business somewhere else, or is that just pie in the sky?
Lenny Wild from the Politics and Governance Programme at ODI. And I think this is a really useful report that builds upon and contributes to growing work across ODI, looking at how politics and governance really affects service delivery. And I think it also really usefully, as Sue picks up, signals a kind of emphasis across our work at ODI and actually getting better at documenting what works, where progress happens and why, and how do we learn from that. So thank you to Heidi and the team. A couple of very quick reflections or questions of things I think we could discuss a bit further. One is, as you know, Heidi, a lot of our work recently has been looking at how do we better understand, diagnose and respond to a whole range of governance constraints that affect service delivery, and you've usefully drilled down into a selection of those. One question for me from these models that seem to effectively address them is, did they start with a really good understanding of what those constraints were and purposefully build programs to address them? Or did this emerge organically through the process of doing the work, which I think was what Rinus was perhaps suggesting happened in the Tanzania case? And does that tell us something about the learning approach that's needed? My second reflection is really, I think, very much in line with Sue's points, that we have this growing convergence now across our work at ODI, linking to the work at Harvard by Matt, IDS's work, World Bank growing body of work, which really says, okay, we actually know something about what politically savvy aid looks like in different sectors. We know it needs to be adaptive, to be learning, to be iterative, to be about brokering and problem solving. And I do think there's a question for us about who's best placed to do that. I thought it was interesting, your cases, actually all of them are being implemented by third parties. What David has referred to as sort of arm's length assistance in a recent ODI brief. And is there, do you think one of the implications of this research is that actually we need to get better at understanding that it's those locally rooted or sometimes internationally linked up, but very locally networked organizations who are best placed to do elements of this? Or are there broader lessons for agencies, development agencies writ large?
Thank you very much. We'll take one more in this round, I think, Marcus, and then I'll give the panel a chance to come up with a few reflections, then I'll take a second round, so please let me know in a minute.
My name is Marcus Maynard. I'm the director of the Budget Strengthening Initiative here at ODI. The real question I want to put to the panel was a conversation we started over lunch, really, which is there something prior to windows of opportunity? And I suppose it's picking up what others have said. There's something about being there already, that, you know, if you're not there already and if you're not there around for the long term, when the window of opportunity comes along, then you won't know it, you won't be able to spot it. And I suppose, is it also a question of being there with some money? that if you don't have the money to respond to the window opportunity, then also you'll spend a whole year getting the money, and by then the window opportunity will have disappeared. So I'd be interested to know any reflections on that. But can I just also echo, I think, what Andy was saying about how you measure in this kind of thing and the need for attribution and better impact monitoring. And one of the things we've found in our project is the need to have a story of change every year to say, okay, what happened, why did it happen, what was our role here, and having those both for the team to reflect on, but also getting them to some extent externally validated where possible by other people as well. So you do need that very granular approach if you're going to do this, to say, well, look, you know, suddenly you've got the water sector is improving, don't quite know what the process was, but at some point you need to tell the story and understand the story of what happened at the level. So that's my answer on the impact. But the question is, you know, do we need to be there and do we need to have money? Is that a condition for being able to take advantage of windows of opportunity?
Thank you. We sometimes worry there'll be a shortage of questions. I think we have the opposite today. I will invite the panel just to offer a few quick reflections. Apologies, we obviously won't be able to get to everything. I also, let me tag on to that, have a question on Twitter from Sumed Rao, who I think is at the University of Birmingham, talking about picking up on Andy Radcliffe's point about windows of opportunity and his question, what defines a pocket of excellence? Let's run quickly through in the order that the presentations ran, Heidi to kick off and then through, and then we'll reserve time for one quick round of questions and response following that.
Okay, great. I think I will tackle the windows of opportunity question first, given that's what a lot of people seem to talk about, although I'm not sure if I can provide a particularly satisfactory answer because I don't have the silver bullet. I think if it was going to be produced, it would have been produced a long time ago. I mean, I think quite seriously, though, in terms of our research, I do feel that, as we sort of discussed in lunch, it became the factor that sort of caught lots of things in our work. And actually, you know, I know researchers shouldn't always use this excuse, but in the next phase, I think it should be looked at in a bit more depth. And I mean, as Sue was saying, perhaps another a piece that would be valuable in this is actually to think about the genesis of these aid programs. How did they really develop? And I think we did that, but we need to look at that a bit more carefully. If I reflect on the aid programs themselves, they try to find these window of opportunities in different ways. I think we felt that, it's actually in this report, so I'll just check the table, certainly for the local government development program, there was a year-long assessment of what was taking place in different parts of the systems, whether there really was political support for this process. I think we felt that in AGI you use sort of a trial and error approach to see what things are working and not are not working, then sort of pushing on doors that sort of slightly open. And then with SNV we found that they implement a power analysis quite regularly. So I think there are different approaches to try and gauge whether these windows of opportunities exist and how they change, but certainly much more I think needs to be done to carefully think about this issue. I think the point about donors and wanting to do more with less is something that I think is an interesting thing, and I think we should take back to donors and challenge them on this. In my mind, value for money is not efficiency, it's effectiveness. It is essentially the money you're spending, the efficiency of that money, and also what results you're getting. And if we're basically saying that you need to spend more money on making sure that you have sufficient people to implement this politically savvy approach on the ground in order to get the results, then that's what we need to do. Otherwise, there's no point having really tightly efficient activities that don't deliver any results. So I do feel that that's what we need to throw back to the donors. In terms of what sort of implementers were able to get this right, and this sort of relates to the window of opportunities point, I think one of the things we touch on in the report is that actually the type of implementer does matter. I mean, it'll be interesting to hear Rhenus's thoughts on this.
You're just talking to the mic.
Sorry, it's interesting to hear Rhenus's thoughts on this, but we noticed this with SNV and also with AGI, and actually some of our experience in BSI more recently, is that you often have people working on the ground that have worked in that country for a long time. they have perhaps the political networks there, or certainly the networks with the local community. They really understand how things work, and therefore, as a result, perhaps they're better able to assess whether these are real windows of opportunity. So I know I'm moving from question to question. I mean, perhaps just lastly on sort of Duncan's point about why are donors getting some of this right and others not? Yeah, sorry, my mind has gone blank on that. Oh. No, I don't know if that's good.
We'll hold you to that. which maybe answers the question.
We'll
give you another chance to come back to that
thanks.
One. I have three questions back, so maybe I'll just quickly see if Reynos, Emmanuel and Sue have any quick points they want to make at this point.
Well, yeah, just maybe on one of the issues which was raised of if those are the activities which need to be done, so in order to get systems to deliver services, we have identified what are the constraints and how to go about it, and then the question is indeed who is going to do it. Whether donors should be doing that, I'm not so sure. From my experience and looking at the donor dynamics, the dialogue between government and donor about these sort of issues is rather polluted by the fact that a lot of money is involved. So we as an agency focusing on capacity building and therefore having the luxury not having to worry about needing to spend lots of money, I believe it gives us the inside-outsider status where on the one hand we need to win the confidence of the policymakers, of the implementers, in order to give advice which they are willing to take on, because we can give advice and they can ignore it, different than with the donor agency. So that gives us the urgency and the need to try and convince them, yet at the same time not being part of the system, so therefore not being answerable in terms of the technical advice we provide, at the same time retaining this independence and autonomy in order to raise the critical questions which sometimes are necessary to break through certain dynamics. So yes, I do think that the inside-outsider status is important for supporting reform, because also, as I mentioned earlier, reform is not a politically neutral event. Politically sensitive issues need to be tackled, need to be addressed, need to be put on the table, and therefore also the outsider status can help there. Yet at the same time, I fully appreciate in the case study, one of the factors mentioned for our interventions in Tanzania is the fact that some of us have been a long time in Tanzania, and sure, I've been 15 years in Tanzania, I think I know the political dynamics, but I think it is more important, not so much the fact that I have been there for a long time, but the fact that we have the right connections with the local institutions and the local organizations in order to be able to grasp those windows of opportunities, because the windows of opportunities, which are indeed crucial, are not out there on the street or in the newspaper. They are the ones which you identify as you go along. Indeed, it is the relationships which need to be built over a long time through an organization, which is very difficult for either a donor to do or for local organizations on their own to do. And it is this combination of arm's length agencies or institutions together with local partners, which I think is suitable for the approach which we have described.
Thank you very much, and thank you for keeping that concise. Emmanuel, I think we can offer you a quick intervention now if you'd like one.
Not for now. I think for now I don't have a comment.
Okay, no problem at all. Sue, is there anything you'd like to...
Could I perhaps just pick up on a couple of questions that haven't been picked up on? The observation from AGI that, you know, it can be difficult to strike a balance between institutional incoherence or getting it, addressing institutional incoherence and political payoffs. I think that's important and tricky, because a lot of... a lot of policy institutional incoherence is driven by populism or sustained in some kind of deliberate way. What I think might be useful to think about as a donor is, can you distinguish between incoherence that is in some way sort of deliberate and incoherence that is accidental and the result of muddle, and you know, the way where some sort of facilitation actually could make a difference. Duncan's point about what are the factors behind donors getting it right. I mean, that's in a way the question I would like to answer by looking at some of these cases. But if I think about one case from DFID, which I still see as a relative success story, and that's the Phlegtee Forest Governance Trade Initiative. And the genesis of that, it was a small group of professional foresters who were very well networked globally, had vast amounts of in-country experience, were able to operate beneath the radar, didn't start by saying to themselves, how do we spend £300 million in the next 2 years, but did say, how do we use all the kind of means at our disposal to try to address this problem about illegal logging. And it was a project that evolved in a kind of making it up as you go along, but in a very informed making it up as you go along way over a period of years. But the interesting thing about it is that ultimately it has ended up spending quite a lot of money. So there isn't necessarily, it isn't necessarily the case that working in this way doesn't spend money. It points to some really important things within agencies about the kind of staff you nurture and value and so on. And then about measurement, the one sort of observation I would have on that is on annual impact monitoring is that you've got to be prepared for ups and downs. You've got to be prepared for a trajectory that isn't a linear one, that, you know, it's obvious, but it's not very easy for a lot of donor agencies to accept.
Thank you very much. If you'll bear with me, I'm going to squeeze in one round of questions more. I had David and Gideon, or we won't be able to take everyone. I'd log David and Gideon and Gargi. Let's see how we go. We'll take those three to start. There's a microphone, I think.
David Booth, the Politics and Governance team at ODI. I have a comment and a question for Rinus. I mean, I like very much all of the things that Rinus said, but particularly the thing that he highlighted, which was perhaps downplayed in our reporting, which is about the failure of these initiatives to try to get movement by generating information and then either getting the bureaucrats to discipline the local providers or get local communities to demand better performance. Because, that observation is completely contrary to what is an extremely large body of opinion, which is constantly growing about the importance of information, transparency, and so forth. In the Africa Power and Politics program, we said, amongst other things, that sort of generating citizen demand by providing information and advocacy about rights was actually a weak driver of progress in performance. Many people, including Duncan Green sitting here, were rather sort of horrified at that proposition, and they thought it was sort of gratuitously having a go at demand-side interventions. I mean, what this experience documents rather interestingly is that it's not just that it's ineffective, but it actually gets in the way of doing what you know to be effective. And that debate with WaterAid is very interesting. But my question is SNV in a position where it can trumpet that insight to the rest of the sort of international donor NGO community? And have they said it to their own funders, who I believe have funded this program in the belief that it is an information and accountability exercise?
Very quick.
Very quick. Quick question for Sue. Gideon Rabinowitz from ODI. My instinct to hearing your conclusion that most donors aren't going to change fundamentally is that they should probably, there are probably certain things they just shouldn't be doing anymore and throwing money at. Can you reflect on that?
Thank you very much. I'm afraid we don't have time for questions. There were just a couple of online comments, one about the relationship between this type of aid and budget support, and I think that sort of discussion around financial transfers versus this sort of different sort of engagement has come up, and a second one around what genuine dialogue might look like versus the sort of policy dialogue that's being critiqued. I'm afraid we're very close to out of time, so I'll just give the panellists, perhaps I'll come quickly to Emmanuel, see if there's anything you'd like to add before we conclude.
Hello. Basically, just thank you for all the fruitful contributions. It was not very clear for me to follow some of the issues which you raised because of the poor connection. But thank you for all the.
Thank you very much, Raz, from your side. I'll maybe quickly come to Rinus, because there was a specific question from David about the Tanzania case, and then ask Sue and give Heidi the final word.
I fully agree with the question that the current donor approach seems to favour getting citizen to demand for services. Our experience indeed point that just raising demand for service is as such not going anywhere, because unless there is a response capacity and unless the government accepts that there is a need to respond to those questions, it's not going to go very, very far. Whether we are able to share it with donors, yes, in terms of, well, we are open about the approach which we are following. However, at the same time, we would like to, what I found very interesting and very helpful in reading the case studies is that when an outsider looks at the work you are doing, you get certain insights which, being part of the dynamic yourself, you may not easily see. So it is the work of ODI in this particular case which will also help us to move that discussion forward, because instead of us talking about our approach, if we can use the ODI reflections in order to explain how our approach works, I think it will strengthen our position. And that is also a little bit my reflection on the documentation of results, because yes, we are being challenged about how to create results, and our results may not easily translate into tangible figures of so many more people reached by water facilities, because this is about sustainability and about changing the system. Also there, I think that independent evaluations, reflections from professionals, peer reviews, could help and strengthen legitimacy of the approach.
Thank you very much.
Are there things donors shouldn't do? Yes.
Are there certain things they just shouldn't throw money at if they're not prepared to work in ways that allow them to do?
I was going to say yes, unless they're prepared to work in ways that the research is suggesting. What I do think is that donors ought to get much better at reflecting what, as external actors, they can bring to the party and what they're less well able to do. In other words, move away from the idea that here's a problem that needs fixing, we can fix it, and say, actually, as external players, there are some things we may be particularly well placed to do, there are other things that we're not at all well placed to do, and get better at making that distinction.
Thank you very much. And Heidi, any final thoughts or comments from you?
Well, I think one, I'll probably follow up afterwards, Duncan, to try and address your two questions and maybe ask the other research to join. But more broadly, I mean, I hope that you found this an interesting set of presentations. As Sue mentioned, you know, this is perhaps reinforcing other ideas and literature that's already out there and circulating. And I think at the very least, I hope this is a small contribution to that, to encourage people to start thinking about building on those experiences that are also working quite well at the moment and documenting them a bit more effectively. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, that's been a fascinating hour and a half. I'm sorry we run a little bit over. The question was raised, what next other than the call for more research? I think certainly we haven't heard someone speaking in a current donor capacity in this audience today, but I think this dialogue is certainly one that we want to take forward. Even on a limited set of five cases, I think there's a fair amount of consensus about the sorts of questions we need to be asking. What are donors well equipped to do? What are other actors of different forms, arm's length or whatever they may be, better placed to do? And also, of course, we want to interrogate further these particular cases and find other examples and see if they bear those out. So we shall certainly keep in touch with you. There'll be a recording of this online almost immediately after the event. And we will be continuing to research this, even only to test that out. And so Duncan has the opportunity to challenge us again in future. But please join me in thanking the research team, Heidi, Rebecca, Helen and David, who I think have done a really first-class job in investigating these cases and setting those up very, very clearly in a report. And along with them are three other panellists, Rinus, Emmanuel and Sue, for some really, really thoughtful and provocative comments today. I think it's been a great discussion. Please join me. Thank you.